Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. İnnel hamdelillah. Vessalatu vesselamu ala Resulillah. İhwan ve ahawat, brothers and sisters and respected elders. Esselamu aleykum rahmetullahi ve berekatuh. I'd like to thank the brothers who organized this event in order for us to talk about the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'd like to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself for facilitating us to be together. And I thank Allah that he has created a very interesting situation in the modern era where you have a Greek who became Muslim and has traveled to Turkey to connect with the hearts of the Turkish people, for us to realize that the brotherhood in Islam doesn't know any boundaries. And this for me is a miracle. It's the miracle of Islam, where the belief in Allah and the love for Allah and the love for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brings people together. Even if they were historical enemies, they become future brothers. And this is the miracle of Islam. This is actually the miracle of the Book of Allah. Because if you look into history, when the Quran was revealed, we see that there were various tribes in Arabia. They were fighting. Sometimes they would fight for years. Sometimes they will fight over a camel. But when the Quran came, it changed the hearts of the Bedouin Arab. It changed the hearts, and the Quran brought them together. So I'd like to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for seeing so many amazing faces in this room. May Allah bless you, grant you Jannah, grant you success in this life and in the Akhirah, and may Allah grant Turkey success. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more barakah in the government of Turkey. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more barakah in your lives, so you all of you here become bastions, become beacons of light, become ambassadors, not only for Turkey, but for Islam. So you revive your Ottoman heritage. Because you all have to understand that your history didn't start 90 years ago. That's not your history. Don't get deluded. Have a longer memory than 90 years. Your history started when the angel Jibreel alayhi salam said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq." Read in the name of your Lord who created. And these first few words, brothers and sisters, changed everything. And that's why you have to understand your history. As Malcolm X once said, if you want to destroy a nation, if you want to destroy a nation, then make them forget their history. And this is why, in order for you to be revived mentally, spiritually, and culturally, you have to revive your history. You have to revive who you were. Because when we think about the book of Allah, that it changed the world, one of the best aspects of history, the best periods of history to think about and look at, is actually the Ottoman history. Because Ottoman history wasn't something unique to a certain people. It was unique to Islam itself. Because the Quran and the beautiful teachings of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were those values and were those principles that actually changed society and created the Ottoman period. Because if you think about the Ottomans, for example, Osmanlı, when you think about the Ottomans were actually a phenomenal, phenomenal entity. Because take economics as an example. Economics. The Ottomans provided people food, shelter, and clothing. This relates to a prophetic tradition to a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, the son of Adam, all he needs is food, shelter, and clothing. Food, shelter, and clothing, which creates an economic philosophy of distribution, not an economic philosophy of excessive competition. And this is exactly what the Ottomans did. They took the values from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They took the values from the Quran. When Allah says in the Quran that wealth shouldn't become a commodity just amongst the rich, we must distribute the wealth. And this is quite interesting because the Food Agricultural Organization that's linked to the UN makes a very similar conclusion in a modern day sense. The Food Agricultural Organization says that we have enough food to feed... Problem? Problem day, la bijim.
Alhamdulillah. Çok güzel. So, when we think about changing the world, we could see it from a perspective of looking at economics. And when the Ottomans looked at the hadith, at the prophetic teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which talked about giving people food, shelter, and clothing, making sure that everyone's limited essential needs are sufficed. And when they look into the Quran, when the Quran talked about the distribution of wealth, the Quran says that wealth shouldn't be just amongst the wealthy, but it should be spread amongst society. These were very key values that shaped Ottoman society. This is why when you talk to the historians and you go to some of the Ottoman mosques, they would say there would be two dome baskets, if you like, marble baskets. And they used to be full of gold, full of gold. And if you were poor, you could take some gold coins, put it in your pocket and have your food and shelter for the day. If you were rich, you could put your hand in and give some sadaqah. The historians say that these sadaqah baskets were always full, which shows that the first time in history or in known history, everybody had food, shelter and clothing. And this is very important because I don't want you to think this is a historical accident. The Ottomans, the reason they were successful from a social political perspective wasn't because of some kind of accident or some kind of new political theory or some kind of new form of secularism. No, it was because of Islam. If you study the Ottoman Constitution, you study the Majalla, you study all of the kind of resources that they had concerning Islam, it was an Islamic environment. They had Islamic philosophy, Islamic thinking, Islamic thought, from economics to society, to ethics, to medicine. Everything had an Islamic basis. And this is why when we look at the success of the Ottomans, you see, especially from an economic perspective, that they actually provided everybody food, shelter, and clothing at a certain period of time. I mean, this is something to be proud about. You may think you know this information, but forget in your brain, put it in your heart. This should make you proud, not in an arrogant sense, in a halal way. Be proud because look at the nations today. Look at Australia, you have homeless people. Look at the United Kingdom, 80,000 homeless families. Look at the United States of America, it can't even feed its own people. In downtown Chicago, children go to school because they could get the only meal they have a day, one meal a day at school. Look at Philadelphia in the projects when people had to basically look into the ground, into the garbage and into the rubbish in order to find some food. This is America. This is America. And your history, our history, because it is our history. The Ottoman history is Islamic history. The Ottoman history is the history of the world because people need to learn from this in order to see how they can succeed from a perspective of economics. So everyone has just distribution. Everyone has food, shelter, and clothing. And this is very important because I wanted to start with this so you realize that if we run away from the values of the Quran, if we run away from the values of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we're just going to have more darkness and more darkness and more darkness. But if we come closer to the Book of Allah, we come closer to the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're going to have more nur and more nur and more nur. Because this is what Islam is about. This is what the Quran is about.
Can you be a bit slower?
Tamam abi. He wants me to be slower. Yavaş yavaş. Tamam? How slow do you want? Okay. So basically, where was I? What was I saying? More nur. Jazakallah khair. So when we adopt the values of the Quran and we adopt the values of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're going to have more light in our lives. And we see this light when it was manifested in our history. And it's not only the Ottomans, but it's also Islamic Spain that we have a lot to learn from. In Islamic Spain, brothers and sisters, there was something which the historians call the convivencia. Convivencia means the coexistence. There was a coexistence between Muslims, Christians, and Jews, just like what we had with the Ottomans. But what's interesting about the convivencia in Spain is that it created something that actually changed the world forever. Listen carefully. And by the way, I'm not making this up. This is Istanbul University. Go to the library, you'll find the books. And they're not written by Muslims. These are non-Muslim academics, okay? So when you look into Islamic Spain was something, a reality that changed the world forever from a perspective of progress. Why am I saying this? Islamic Spain had a political tranquility because it implemented the values of the Quran and the values of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What were these values? What were they? And how did they manifest themselves in Spain? For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us to be just. Allah tells us that He loves the just. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who have believed, be just witnesses for Allah. And don't let the hatred of others make you swerve away from justice. Be just, for it's closer to your duty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran to be kind, to have rahmah for people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in the various hadith, the prophetic traditions, that whoever harms a non-Muslim under our protection harms the Prophet himself. So we have all of these values concerning minorities, concerning justice, concerning harmony and tranquility. And these values were implemented in Islamic Spain, and it created the tranquility for Muslim, Jew, Christian to look into the interconnecting principles of nature, to look into man, life and the universe, to look into how things work. Because the Quran also encouraged us to look at how things work. When Allah says, do you not examine the realm of the heavens and the earth? So we had spiritual motivation to do science and to be progressive.
We had the right values to create a society in Islamic Spain for everyone to work together to look into the science and look into discoveries. And what's very interesting is that in Islamic Spain, there was a huge revival of these type of sciences. You had manuscripts on astronomy, on physics, on mathematics, on so many different things. And what's very interesting, you have a very special figure in Islamic history, in Islamic Spain rather, and his name is Musa bin Maymun, also known as Maimonides. He wasn't a Muslim, he was a Jew. But the Jewish people, they consider him as the second Moses. They consider Musa bin Maymun, Maimonides, as the second Moses. He was from the Islamic culture of Spain. Yes, he was a Jew, but he developed all of his theology as a result of studying with Muslims, by the way. So it goes to show that these people, Muslim, Jew, and Christian, were working together, even from a theological perspective. Now, going back to the sciences, we had manuscripts on mathematics, on astronomy, on physics. And when the Christians took over Toledo, took over Spain, what did they find? They found all of these manuscripts, and they took the manuscripts back to Europe and translated them. And this was a key moment in the history of the West, because it created that needed intellectual environment in order for Europe to propel itself into the Renaissance. Professor Thomas Arnold, in his book, The Preaching of Islam, on page 131, he says that Islamic Spain, Muslim Spain, was that first nation, if you like, that facilitated Europe to go into the Renaissance. Because the Muslims took from the Greek culture, took from the Indian culture, improved the medicine, improved the sciences, and actually developed things that were unprecedented. And this is very important for us to realize, because it was because of the values of the Quran and the values of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if we didn't have those values in Islamic Spain, we wouldn't have the convivencia. We wouldn't have the coexistence between different peoples in order to investigate into the sciences. And this is why it's very interesting, because we should be so proud of our history, that this book, the book of Allah, actually changed the world. And if it's true that the book of Allah changed Islamic Spain, and Islamic Spain developed the sciences, and then these sciences were taken by the Europeans, and it facilitated the Renaissance, then we can make a very bold claim. We can say that if it wasn't for the Quran, if it wasn't for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you would not have the iPhone. But it's true. Think about it. If you never had European Renaissance, you would never have the scientific progress that is needed in order for us to discover the iPhone or to develop the iPhone. And what's interesting, if you never had Islamic Spain, you wouldn't have the Renaissance. And if you never had the Quran and the Sunnah, you wouldn't have Islamic Spain. So here's the link. iPhone, Renaissance, Islamic Spain, Quran and Sunnah. It's a direct link. This is why what I think we should do is go to the Apple store in Istanbul and ask for a free iPhone 6. Because it's our heritage. If it wasn't for Islam, you wouldn't have the algorithm. If it wasn't for Islam, you wouldn't have the necessary milestones in history in order for Europe to look into the interconnecting principles of nature. And this is why the modern founder of capitalism, relatively modern, 18th century, Adam Smith, he says, and you can find this in one of his essays called Adam Smith's Essays, published by London. and published in London. And he said, the empire of the caliphs, the empire of the Muslim leadership was that first date that created the needed tranquility for people to look into the interconnecting principles of nature. Because these thinkers were just, they understood that the Islamic environment was the ideal environment for all peoples to come together with tolerance, with harmony, so they could investigate. Now, by the way, this doesn't mean that only Muslims did the science. No. It was non-Muslims too. But the point I want you to realize is that where did this political environment come from to bring all the different peoples together in order to investigate into the sciences? It was the Islamic values of tolerance and harmony and rahmah and progress. And this is something that we should be very proud as Muslims to show to people, that when you look at other examples in modern times, not to point the finger at anybody, but when you look at other examples of darkness and destruction, you just need to remind people just to look back a little bit into history to see our glorious past. And that glorious past was as a result of the Book of Allah and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I could even take this further. I would even argue that the first scientist was a Muslim. I'm not saying this, I'm not making this up. It's not a crazy mad mufti. Okay? It's an academic. David C. Lindbergh. He's a historian. He's a historian of science. And he discussed and said that Ibn al-Haytham was the first formal scientist. In the 11th or 10th century, he wrote the book on optics. And in this book, he formalized the scientific method. He formalized the scientific method. And many historians call him the first scientist. Yes, the Greeks before him thought about science. But Ibn al-Haytham, he was practicing the science. He developed a formal experimental method. And that's why many academics in history, or the historians of the academics of history, basically say that Ibn al-Haytham was the first scientist. Now, what's very interesting, brothers and sisters, is that Ibn al-Haytham, he wrote a biography. His biography states that the reason he did science, that the reason he developed the scientific method in his own way, was because he wanted to come close to Allah. Because the Book of Allah tells us to examine the realms of the heavens and the earth. The Book of Allah tells us to examine what's within our souls. Because the human being, brothers and sisters, is a micro universe. It's a small universe within this macro universe, within this big universe. And this reminds me of a poem of Iqbal. Who's heard of Iqbal, the poet? You don't know him? Learn him. He was an Asian Pakistani poet, but a very amazing poet, to the point some of our scholars say that his poetry was a tafsir of Quran. His poetry was tafsir of Quran. And this reminds me of the following poem. He said, for the disbeliever, he is lost in the universe. But for the believer, the universe is lost in him. Meaning that when a Muslim or when a believer looks into creation, looks into the cosmos, he internalizes it. And he understands that there is a wisdom in the universe, that something created the universe, and that thing deserves worship, deserves for me to know him and to love him. And this is very powerful. So from this perspective, brothers and sisters, we see that the values of the Quran actually did change the world. We saw it in Ottoman history, which gave people food, shelter, and clothing. Even today we can't give people food, shelter and clothing, even in places like the United Kingdom and the United States of America. We also see that the values of the Quran and the prophetic teachings changed Europe forever. Changed Europe forever. Because it was that first state that created that tranquility on a social political level for all people to discover the sciences. Now contrast this to Europe, to medieval Europe. Medieval Europe was in an absolute mess. Absolutely mess. And the reason being is because they didn't have the correct values or the correct social political structures in order for different peoples to live together. And this leads me to the next point on how the Quran changed the world. Because Europe in the medieval period, Europe was at war with itself. Even Christians will kill Christians. If you study European history, you see that the Catholic Church at the time would use the coercive arm of the state to prevent any thinking. Now, I'm not making this up. Read the works of Professor John Sharvey from the London School of Economics. I'm not making this up. It's not stories, it's not fiction. This is European history. Now, European history concerning the Catholic Church and interpretation of the Catholic Church, because not all Catholic conceptions of politics is the same, of course. An interpretation of the Catholic Church, when it had power, would prevent people from basically trying to discuss and investigate things that was against its doctrine. Now, many Christians would say that's against Christianity. Yes, we agree. But we're just talking about the history, not about theology. So what the Catholic Church would do would create this kind of intellectual oppression. And this facilitated many things. For example, you had the likes of Martin Luther. Martin Luther, he wrote a thesis against the Catholic tradition and he pegged it on a church door in Wittenberg in Germany. And basically, that facilitated the Protestant movement. Now, if you also add economic issues at the time, trade issues at the time, that created what you call the religious wars. Europe was known to fight itself concerning religious dogma and concerning trade laws and all of these things. So from this perspective, there wasn't much of a convivencia going on. There wasn't a coexistence. You had the 30-year wars, you had the 80-year wars, you had the massacre on St. Bartholomew's Day. I mean, Europe was swimming in its own blood. And this is very important for us to understand, because when you contrast it to Islamic history, you see something very different. Now, so Europe was swimming in its own blood from that perspective. Not only this, when you even go to the Byzantium era, before 1453, when Sultan Fatih, he came and conquered Constantinople, Istanbul. The Byzantines, do you know what they were doing? They were oppressing their own Christian sects, such as the Jacobites. The Jacobites were being oppressed by their own people. So the Byzantine regime was a very oppressive regime that was even oppressing minority Christian sects. So look at this history from Europe and contrast it with the history of Islam. Because when the Muslim nations like the Ottomans and Islamic Spain, when they used the values of the Quran and Sunnah and implemented them in their hearts, but also in society, they actually tolerated minorities. Consider the Jacobites. The Jacobites survived because of Islam. If it wasn't for Islam, you may have not had many of these Christian sects that you have today. Because the Christians were killing each other. And when Islam took over harmoniously, you see that it created a model that said, people of different religions can live together in harmony. And this was very important. This is why A.S. Tritton, he's an academic, he wrote an academic book called the caliphs and the non-Muslim subjects. It was a study of the covenant of Umar. I think it's published by Routledge Academic Press. And what he quotes is very fascinating. He says Christians preferred Muslim rule to that of the Christians. Allahu Akbar. This is amazing. And it's because of the values that we implemented, brothers and sisters, which is so important. Because of these key values from the Quran and the prophetic traditions, the prophetic teachings. Now, what's also very interesting as well is when we talk about minorities, we actually see that Islam, especially in the Ottoman period and in Islamic Spain, actually took care of the Jews, the Jewish community. Because when you look at the history of the Jews, you see that they were massacred, you see that the Jews were killed and they were oppressed. Look, you know what happened in Europe, in Germany, in the 1940s. They killed 6 million Jews. And what's very fascinating, that the head, the editor of the New York Times, he's from the Jewish community, he said, if Europe was conquered by Muslims, you would still have 6 million more Jews today. So what you see with the Jewish community is that the Jewish academics themselves, they actually say amazing things about how we changed the situation for them. Take for example, 1453. In 1453, when we captured Constantinople, the Jews fled from persecution in Spain and persecution in Europe. And you have a letter in Philip Mansell's book, he's a historian, the book is called Constantinople. He quotes a letter from a Jewish rabbi, and the letter says, "All my brethren, all my brothers, come to the land of the Turks. Rich are the fruits of the earth. We're not oppressed with heavy taxes. We're not oppressed with heavy taxes, and we live in peace and freedom."
This was a rabbi writing in 1453. Also, you have other Jewish historians. Amnon Cohen, he wrote a book, A World Within. It's a two-volume book, and he took 1,000 records from the judiciary at the time of Osmanlı, at the time of the Ottoman period. And he looked at these records and he was fascinated. And he said that although the Jewish community had their own right to go to the rabbinical courts, the majority of the Jews wanted to go to the Qadi, the Islamic judge. This is a Jewish historian, academic saying this, not a Muslim, studying Islamic history in the Ottoman period. And you know what's really funny as well? In these records, he looks at them and he says that the Jewish community was so comfortable, essentially, with the Qadi, that Jewish women would go to the Qadi and would even complain about nafaqa. Nafaqa in Islam means maintenance of the household, maintenance of his wife, to provide food, shelter and clothing. Which I think is very interesting, because it goes to show from a sociological perspective that Islam allowed its minorities so much freedom and liberty, and especially social ease and harmony, in order for even women, Jewish women, to go to the Qadi and complain about internal house affairs. I mean, that's amazing. That's absolutely amazing. So we see from even this perspective, the Islamic values that were implemented by the Ottomans and by the leaders in Islamic Spain actually created an amazing environment to preserve the Jewish people. Because people were persecuting them, but under Islam, they thrived. And this is something that we should be proud of as Muslims, brothers and sisters.
Because I don't want to talk to you about this and then you feel nice for one day and then you go home and it's same story. I don't want you to suffer from spiritual diabetes. And this is not spiritual insulin for you. Okay? I want you to really take this on board so you could be encouraged to do your own studies. So you could be encouraged to open your mouth, not to hide anymore. Because Muslims, we can't afford to hide anymore. People are waiting for you to speak. The whole world is waiting for Islam to raise its voice. The true voice of Islam. The voice of peace. The voice of rahmah. The voice of justice. The voice of distribution of wealth. The voice of harmony. The voice of tolerance. This is what the world needs. You can't be hiding anymore, brothers and sisters. You can't have people coming every year to the same conferences and listening to the same things. Enough, khalas. It's time to arise and warn. Qum fa'anzir. Allah says, arise and warn. You have all of the resources at your disposal. MashaAllah, you're strong. MashaAllah, you're powerful. MashaAllah, you have money as well. MashaAllah, you have good food. Right? You have an intellectual tradition. You have everything at your disposal. Now is the time for you to articulate a positive, compassionate case for Islam. Don't forget, we are ukhrijat linnas. Allah tells us, we are here for the people. Linnas. The Arabic, linnas. Not minannas. We're not from them. We're for them. Now this is not supposed to create arrogance and kibr. No. It's supposed to humble us. To make us realize that we're here for people if we adopt the values of the Quran and the prophetic traditions. To take care of humanity. This is what Muslims are about. Allah says we are shuhada and annas. We're here, we're witnesses over mankind. To take care of people. To facilitate their affairs. Why is it, brothers and sisters, that 8 million people die of starvation every year in the world, according to UNICEF? And the majority of those people are children under the age of 5. Why have you and me allowed such a situation? This is the real terrorism. If you want to play a numbers game, this is the real terrorism, allowing 8 million people to die because of starvation, because of no food, when we know there is enough food on this planet. Look how fat some of the Americans have become. Look how fat some of the Saudis have become. Look how fat some of the Qataris have become. No offense, but we've become obese. We've got so much food, we don't know what to do with it. And we waste and we waste and we waste. The issue is not about we don't have enough food. The issue is about distribution of wealth. Why have we allowed such a situation to happen? As Muslims, this should not happen at all. And if it does happen, we need to warn people.
And show them the right way forward. To teach them about the distribution of wealth. To teach them about the Islamic values of economics. Because we're going to be accountable on the Day of Judgment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want you to take this as a sense of responsibility that every single one of you have a voice. And this is why I don't want these sessions, these conferences, just to make you feel nice for a few minutes. And then you go back home, you go back to sleep, and it's the same old routine. The same old routine. I want you to be revived. I want this to be like seeds that are planted in your heart and your mind so they could grow into the fruits of transformation. This is what we want. Because to be honest, brothers and sisters, if you look at the politics around the world and what's happening, I think all eyes are on Turkey at the moment. Relatively economically stable, social stability, taking some kind of leadership in the world at the moment, creating good dynamic relationship with other leaders, has an Islamic ethos, is harmonious, it's reviving its tradition of making sure that all the minorities live harmoniously, the Turks, the Kurds, the Armenians, and everybody else, right?
And there's this slow, interesting progression towards these Islamic values, which is creating a lot of harmony. So I think eyes are on Turkey at the moment. Eyes are on Turkey, eyes are on you. So the question is, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to sit in conferences and just say, oh, alhamdulillah, a Greek brother, he became Muslim, he said a few things in Turkish, I feel so happy, and he said a few things about the Ottomans, I feel so great, ha ha ha ha ha. You're not children. You're not children, you're adults, you're leaders. You have to see yourself as a leader. Every Muslim is a leader. Every Muslim is a leader. This is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Everyone is a shepherd. We are all shepherds. And we all have something to manage, our flock. And you need to lead your families, lead yourselves, and lead your society. Because think about it, brothers and sisters. You know, the Quran not only changed the world, but it's supposed to change you. It's supposed to change you. Are you going to just be born, educate yourself, get a good job, get money, get married, have kids, and then die? Is that your life? Is that your life? Born, marriage, kids, death? Is that your life? Well, we need to think about this. Because if that is your life, then you're no different from a cow, a sheep, and a donkey. Honestly. And I say this about myself. Because all of these things are just based on instinct. Survival, reproduction. That's what a cow does when it's eating grass. It's surviving, and then it mates with its friend, and it reproduces. Right? We do the same. I don't care if you have a PhD. I don't care if you've got a great job. It still is based on instinct, survival, reproduction. I don't care if you wrote your wife poetry. Makes no difference. It's still based on an instinct. I don't care if you went to this amazing island for your honeymoon. It's still based on instinct, procreation. Many of the things that we do in our lives is based on these core animal instincts. Even the big houses that we buy and the big cars that we have. This is all just shiny stuff. But it reduces itself to the core animal instinct of survival. Is your life just going to be about survival reproduction? Is that it? Or are you going to do something about your life? Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِرُسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُهْيِيكُمْ. Oh, you who have believed. Talking to you. Not talking to your next door neighbor. Talking to you. The book of Allah is one big love letter to you. Because it's from His rahmah that He revealed this book. And Allah is saying to you, oh, you who have believed. Respond to the call of Allah and His messenger to that which gives you life. Imam Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him, he said, the response here is the response to all that is good. And all that is good is Islam. So Allah is telling us what's going to give us real life. Because the ulama, the scholars say about this ayah, that if you don't respond to the call of Allah and His messenger, then you're dead Muslim walking. Your heart is dead. Your spiritual heart is dead. And you're just like an animal, just obeying your instincts. Born, marriage, kids, death. And in between, lots of yemek. Right? We need to elevate ourselves, brothers and sisters. We need to elevate ourselves and understand that the real change of the Quran wasn't just about changing Ottoman life. It wasn't about just changing Spanish life in Islamic Spain. It wasn't about just economics. Why did these things happen? That's the question I want you to ask. Why did they happen? Nia, right? Why did they happen? They happened not because of the values themselves, because people carried the values. The Sahaba, the Muslims, they carried the values of the Quran and Sunnah, not only just in their minds, but it was in their hearts. So really, when the Quran changed the world, it's because it changed people. Think about this, brothers and sisters. 80 years after the death of our beloved Prophet, and according to the ulama, the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the greatest calamity for the ummah. It was the greatest calamity for the ummah. But 80 years after his death, we were in Pakistan, in Multan, and we were in Spain. And it was 82 years after his death that the Muslims decided to fix the masjid of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was still dripping of water. It goes to show the people at the time, they knew what created change was a change of mind and a change of heart. A spiritual, intellectual transformation. Not just building buildings. Yes, we have amazing mosques in Ottoman history. I love them. They're beautiful. The best architecture ever. But to be honest, a mosque doesn't change society. A building doesn't change society. Cement doesn't change society. Rocks do not change society. Pestle and mortar doesn't change society. Bricks don't change society. Even money doesn't change society. What changes society is values, is thoughts, is ideas, is your spiritual disposition. And this is why the early Muslims, the reason just in 80 years after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we were in Pakistan and Spain implementing the justice and harmony and peace of Islam. Because it was about people of substance. The Quran changed and transformed the hearts of man. So that's the real change. We could talk about Ottoman history and Islamic Spain and medieval Baghdad until we get fed up. But the real question today is, how is the Quran going to change your heart? How is the Book of Allah going to change your heart? And I want us to focus on this because it's very important for the future. We shouldn't have a historical complex. Don't be like the Greeks. Just because there was Aristotle and Plato, the Greeks think they're something. But they don't know anything. Because what are they now? They're just slaves of Germany. But that's a different economic problem. But the point is, we need to realize, don't have a historical complex. Because when we look into Ottoman history, we should see it as a motivation to look into the future. And this is why when we say the Quran changed the world, means it changed people's hearts in order for them to change the world. So how do we now change our hearts? There's so many things we need to do from a spiritual, social level. The first thing we need to start to revive, brothers and sisters, is to start connecting with the Book of Allah. Allah says in Surah Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahman. Do you know what Ar-Rahman means? It doesn't mean the merciful. There is no word in any language, whether Turkish or English, that really describes what Ar-Rahman means. Ar-Rahman has three key elements to its meaning. Number one, the mercy of Allah is very intense. Number two, the mercy of Allah is so powerful that nothing can stop. Number three, Allah's mercy is immediate. So Allah tells us Ar-Rahman. And then He says, He taught the Quran. Some ulama, some scholars say, this means that the Quran is from His mercy. So in other words, the Quran is one giant love letter to humanity. The Quran is one big love letter to human beings. Yahamakullah. So the Quran is one big love letter to humanity. And Allah is telling us that in order for our hearts to be unlocked, we must do tadabbur, reflect on the Quran. As Allah says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Do they not reflect upon the Quran, or are there locks on their hearts? This could mean, brothers and sisters, that the more tadabbur, the more reflection we do on the Quran, the more our hearts become unlocked to receive Allah's mercy and Allah's guidance. We need to start to be people of tadabbur of Quran. Yes, memorization is good. Yes, recitation is good. It's a shifa. It's a healing. It's a mercy for the believers. But we need to take the next step forward. We need to make sure that we reflect upon the Quran so the Quran is internalized. We become the Quran. And this can only happen when you every day or regularly connect with the words of Allah. Try to find out what Allah is saying to you. Try to find out what Allah wants to teach you. Try to find out what Allah wants from you. Try to find out what these verses mean for you and how they affect your life and how they can change you. Brothers and sisters, when we start to connect with the Quran in this way, not just memorization, not just recitation, but tadabbur. As Allah says, reflect upon His book, or are our hearts locked? So when we continue with the tadabbur of the Quran, our hearts become unlocked to receive His mercy and His guidance. And this is extremely important, brothers and sisters. Because when you do tadabbur on the Quran, so many beautiful things awaken your soul. For example, take Surah Yusuf. Surah Yusuf is an amazing surah. It's the greatest story ever told. Now Surah Yusuf explains to us, Allah explains to us in this chapter, that this chapter is for the Sa'ilin. The Sa'ilin are those who seek the truth. They are those who seek the truth. And there are so many lessons in this chapter. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, famous 14th century scholar, he said there are around 1,000 lessons or more just in this chapter. There are more lessons than verses. There are more lessons in this chapter than it has verses. And this chapter talks to us about forgiveness, about da'wah, about patience, about tolerance, about overlooking people's faults, about so many different things, about the plan of Allah, about His mercy, about depression. And when you look into this chapter and have the mind of someone who's reflecting, who's doing tadabbur on the book of Allah, you will see things that you would never imagine. For example, in this chapter, one of the central characters is Yaqub alayhi salam, the father of the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. Now we all know this story. Yusuf alayhi salam was missing. Binyamin was also missing, his younger brother. And Yaqub alayhi salam was so distressed. He was so distressed. He had so much anguish that he didn't know what to do. He was crying and upset. Imagine a father losing his sons. And he said, I complain about my grief to Allah alone. And then straight after this ayah, what does he say? He advises his sons, his other sons, the 10 sons who are supposed to be looking for Yusuf and Binyamin. He advises them, go and look for Yusuf and his akhi and his brother. And do not despair of the Ruhillah. Do not despair of the life-giving mercy of Allah. For only those who reject the truth despair of the life-giving mercy of Allah. Let's do tadabbur here. What's very interesting is that we learn a lesson from Yaqub alayhi salam. And the lesson is, if you have grief, the first thing you must do, go straight to Allah. He is the one who put you in this situation. He is the one who can make you understand what's going on. He is the one who could help you overcome your problems and your situation. Because he is the one who put this plan in your life. So go and complain to Allah alone. And the other lesson we learn is that when we have grief, to overcome our grief, remind others of the mercy of Allah. Because think about it, Yaqub alayhi salam was so upset, was so in grief concerning the loss and his sons were missing. And he told his other sons who were looking for them, do not despair of Allah's mercy, for Allah is the most merciful. This is what essentially he was saying. And that only those who reject Allah, reject the truth, despair of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from here we get two key lessons on how to deal with grief. Complain to Allah alone and remind others of Allah's mercy. Allahu Akbar. There are so many other things we could look into the Quran, do tadabbur. Now the reason I mention these things is to encourage you to continue to do tadabbur with the Quran, to ponder on the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's by pondering that Allah tells us our hearts may be unlocked. Maybe that's what Allah is trying to say. Do they not reflect upon the Quran, or are there locks on their hearts? The more reflection you do, the more your heart becomes unlocked to receive His mercy and guidance. Now you may think, what's this got to do with changing the world? It has everything to do with changing the world. Because remember, if our hearts are not transformed by the Quran, we will never transform society. The reason the early Ottomans were successful, the reason the early rulers of Islamic Spain were successful, the reason we were relatively successful in Islamic history, because the people who were in power and the people who were governed had hearts that deserved success. And their hearts were yearning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a key point on transforming our hearts is to do tadabbur of Quran. Does this make sense? Evet. The second point, in order for the Quran to change our hearts, make sure that we are always in a state of tawbah, that we repent to Allah. Allah says in the Quran, all believers, all of you, repent, come back, turn back to Allah in order for you to be successful. Tawbah, brothers and sisters, is part of purifying our hearts and making us successful. The Quran is telling us. The Quran is not saying, make sure you learn about Islamic Spain and about the Ottoman history and then you'll be changed. No. The Quran is basically saying, do tadabbur on the Quran, do tawbah to Allah, and then you will be like those people. Because it's about changing our hearts to deserve success. So the next point is tawbah, repenting to Allah. Allah tells us, it's not my words, I'm not making this up. The Lord of the world is saying, in order for you to change your heart, in order for you to be successful, all of you believers together, repent to Allah. And what's very powerful here, brothers and sisters, is who are we repenting to? Allah is the merciful. He is the forgiving. He is the kind. He is the compassionate. And Allah's mercy is so phenomenal that He tells us, Ya Ibadi, O my believing servants, do not despair of the mercy of Allah, for Allah forgives all sins. This is Allah. And Allah is so happy in a way that befits His perfection and majesty. He is so happy when His servants come back to Him. Because tawbah is an act of coming back to Allah, repenting to Allah. And there's an amazing story to show how happy Allah is when one of you were sinful, then repented to Allah. And the story is as follows, and it's found in the traditions of the hadith. There is this man with his camel, and he's in a desolate area. Imagine, it's like an ocean of sand everywhere. And what happens is his camel disappears and runs away. So this man, he's trying to look for his camel, because if he can't find his camel, he knows he's going to die. No water, too much heat, is too far to travel, he will die. So he's sitting down, or he's lying back on a tree, and all of a sudden, his camel walks by. He gets so happy, he grabs the camel, and he basically says, out of his happiness, he's so ecstatic with his happiness, he says, "Oh Allah, you are my servant, and I am your Lord." He utters a statement of shirk. Now I'm paraphrasing the story here, but the point here is Allah is even more happy than this man, who had to be so crazy with his happiness because he found his camel, that he did this accident, he made this ridiculous statement that he didn't mean. Allah is happy when you repent to Him. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Allah. And this is why we need to put this into practice, that we always, as a daily practice, follow the prophetic model of repentance. Well, the Prophet ﷺ would ask for tawbah over 70 times a day. Put this in your spiritual practice. And don't just say it, just words. Your heart has to mean it. Because when we say these things, our heart has to incline to the words. The third point for the Quran to change our hearts is to remember Allah. Dhikrullah. Allah says, indeed, in the remembrance of Allah, do hearts find peace, do hearts find rest. And the dhikr of Allah cleans the heart and makes it ready for success. And this is why we need to start to engage in the dhikr of Allah in accordance with the Quran and the prophetic model. You know how powerful the remembrance of Allah is, brothers and sisters? Ibn Qayyum al-Jawziyyah, the 14th century theologian, he said, if you were to do dhikr for your whole life and you miss just one hour, and then you try to make up this 1 hour by doing a whole lifetime worth of dhikr, you will never be able to make up that hour. That's how powerful the remembrance of Allah is. And the remembrance of Allah, brothers and sisters, is like a purification. And I want to give you some principles for us to understand what it means to remember Allah. An-Nawawi, the famous Shafi'i scholar, he wrote a book called Kitab al-Afkar. Kitab al-Afkar, the book of dhikr, the book of remembrances. And in this book and other works, he mentions some principles of doing good dhikr. For example, some of us, after salah, we don't do good dhikr. We do machine gun dhikr. Right? You see some brothers and sisters after salah, Allahu Akbar. Yeah? This is not dhikr. This is mouth exercise. Dhikr is when you're saying the words, you say it softly, silently, properly. For example, if you say, Subhanallah, say Subhanallah. But not only the sound, but your heart must say Subhanallah. That your heart must mean glory be to Allah. When you say Alhamdulillah, this means all gratitude belongs to Allah. All thanks belong to Allah. All praise belong to Allah. When you say it, make sure your heart means it. This is dhikr. This is dhikr. And the reason many of our Ottomans and many of the leaders in Islamic Spain and even the Sahaba, the reason they were successful, because they were people of remembering Allah. They were people of remembering Allah to the point where the Sahaba had to put stones in their mouths when they were going to the toilet, Because there would always be in a state of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you may think, what has happened to Hamza? He's talking about all of these spiritual things, yeah? But you know what, brothers and sisters? This is how we change our hearts. Pondering upon the Qur'an. Doing tawbah and doing dhikr. These are essential things for us, brothers and sisters. Because if we don't do these things, then how are we going to get Osman Le back again? How?
Our hearts have to deserve it. And our hearts have to be ready to be the new leaders of the world. So when we start seeing this in our lives, then maybe Allah will give us the success. And maybe, inshallah, Osman Le gelecek. But there's one more thing to the formula. One more thing to the formula. And that is, one of the main reasons the Quran changed the world is, yes, it changed hearts so we could change the world. But it changed hearts that these hearts wanted to call to Allah. To start to get involved in da'wah. Because brothers and sisters, whether you like it or not, and we have to be honest with our history, one of the failures of the Ottomans towards the end is that we got a bit greedy. Right? Look at the big palaces. The toilets were made of gold. SubhanAllah. Right? We got a bit materialistic. We start copying the French. No offense to anyone. No offense to anyone French here, okay? But you know, we start copying the European lifestyle. That we had to be like their kings and their queens. And we amassed wealth. Thinking wealth gave us power. Wealth never gave us power, brothers and sisters.
It was Islam and our connection with Allah that gave us power. And the fact that we called other people to Allah. Because da'wah was the thing that changed the world. Calling people to Allah. As Allah says, "Udu'u ila sabili rabbik." Call to the way of your Lord. To the sabil, to the path of Allah. Because da'wah is the thing that changes the world, brothers and sisters. And da'wah is the thing that Allah calls to. If you read all of the stories of the prophets. These stories are what? They're not stories of dhikr. They're not stories of tahajjud. They're not stories of halal meat. They're not stories of how to dress yourself. These stories are stories of what? I can't hear you. Da'wah. These stories are stories of tawheed and da'wah. And I'm going to say something very brave here. You will never be able to connect with the stories in the Quran. You will never be able to connect with the book of Allah unless you're walking the path of Allah. Because these stories are about da'wah. If you don't give da'wah, if you don't have a life of da'wah, you will never engage with these stories. They will be abstract for you. You're not walking the path of the Quran will not make sense to you. You will not be spiritually complete. You will not, I repeat, be spiritually complete unless you start to call people to Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. You won't truly believe. You won't believe, sister. You won't believe, brother. Unless you love for your brother what you love for yourself. And this brotherhood is not Muslim brotherhood. This is insaniya. An-Nawawi said that this is humanity. Imam Rajab al-Hanbali, in his compendium of knowledge and wisdom, he says this means human beings because he looks at other hadith, other prophetic traditions that say an-nas. That you must love for an-nas, for the people, what you love for yourself. We won't taste the fruits of iman, the sweetness of iman, unless we love for others what we love for ourselves. So the question is, who do you love the most? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if you want to truly believe, then the Prophet is telling us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, give what you love to others. So how do you give the love of Allah? How do you give the love of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to other people? What do you have to do? You have to give da'wah. This creates a self-image psychology. If you consider yourself someone who wants to come closer to Allah, you have to start giving dawah. The Prophet is saying this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يؤمنوا. You won't truly believe unless you love for others what you love for yourself. This is about our self-image psychology. Allah says in the Quran, this is about our success. You want Ottoman history to be revived? You want Islamic Spain again? You want peace and justice in the world? Do you want peace and justice in the world? I can't hear you. Well, the way to do this is to call to Islam. Allah says this, success is based upon this. وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدُعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْحَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Let there rise amongst you a group of people like you that will call to the khayr, the good. Ibn Kathir said this is the whole of Islam. They call to the good. They command the right. They forbid the wrong. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And they are the ones who attain success. And the greatest success is not the success in the dunya, but it's the akhirah, as Imam Al-Qurtubi said about this, that this means Al-Jannah. So if you want to change the world, brothers and sisters, if you want to change the world, you need to start giving da'wah in the way that you can. I'm not saying that you have to be like our beloved brother, may Allah bless him, Numan Ali Khan. He's amazing. Allah preserving. Allahumma barik lahu. Allah put barakah in his life even more. I'm going to see him next week in Texas. I'm going to give him your salam. And I'm going to tell him to come to Turkey. Inshallah. I'm not saying you have to be like this, but in your own way. In your own way, brothers and sisters, do your bit. Do your bit. Talk to people about Allah. Directly call them to Tawheed, which frees them from the slavery of the world and liberates them into the expanse of Jannah and the expanse of worshipping Allah. This is what we want to do. We want to care for people. We want to give people good news. We want to also warn them of what it means by running away from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to get involved in da'wah. Because da'wah as well, brothers and sisters, also can answer our du'a. Do you know this? Du'a is the weapon of the believer, right? If you're sick, you make du'a. If you're happy, you make du'a. If you're sad, you make du'a. If someone's not well, you make du'a. If there are political problems, you make du'a. If there are social problems, du'a. Family problems, du'a. Du'a, du'a, du'a. It's the weapon of the believer. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, You will command the good and you will forbid the evil, which is da'wah. You will command the good and you will forbid the evil. And if you do not, Allah will send a calamity upon you and you would raise your hands in du'a and your du'a will not be answered. Allahu Akbar. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us here that giving da'wah, commanding good, forbidding the wrong is part of the process of our du'as maybe being answered. This is important, brothers and sisters. It defines who you are, da'wah. We give the thing that we love to others or we won't truly believe. It gives us success, as we said. And also it answers our du'a. But what's significant, brothers and sisters, it elevates you. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ and who is better in speech than the one who calls to Allah and does good deeds and says, I am one of the Muslims. The ulama say here that Allah is saying the one who calls to the values of Islam, to Tawheed, to his oneness, this person is the best. The best person is not the one with a PhD and 5 degrees. And big houses, and all the riches, and owns all the businesses. This is not the best person. Allah is telling us who the best person is. The best person who calls to Allah, and he does righteous deeds. This is what we must teach our society, our children. Allah is giving us the priorities here, brothers and sisters. Allah is giving us priorities. That the best people are those who call to Allah and do good deeds. And da'wah, brothers and sisters, is the most rewardable thing in the world. There's a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, and I'm paraphrasing, if you call to someone, if you call someone to a good, you will get reward of that good. So imagine the da'wah. You call someone to Islam, you call someone to pray, you call someone to read Quran, you call someone to believe in Allah, you call someone to feel the harmony of Islam. You will be getting that reward. And if they get married, and they have two kids, and their two kids have two kids, and they get married, within a generation you'll be getting the reward of the salah, and the fasting, and the sawm, and the hajj, and the umrah, and the reading of the Quran, and the sadaqah, and all of these things of these people. You will be getting the reward. And on the day of judgment on your mizan, you will see all of these deeds. Dhikr, afkar, dua, Quran, hajj, all of these things that you never did. And you may even say, I never did this. But it all belongs to you. Because you called one person sincerely, for the sake of Allah, to Islam. There's nothing more rewardable than calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing more rewardable. So this is very significant, brothers and sisters. Dawah changes the world. Because how do you think the Ottomans became the Ottomans? Who were they before Islam? Do you know? Does anyone know who the Ottomans were before Islam? Give me an answer. Does anyone know? Sorry? Who were they?
They were pagans.
They were pagans, but as a culture, who were they? They were like, a lot of them were barbarians as well. They were nomads. Some of them were nomads, some people were backwards. Yeah, before Islam, look, who were the Sahaba before Islam? They were polytheists, pagans, burying the daughters alive. They were burying the daughters alive. There used to be flags on the tents of women's houses, which used to mean all men could go inside, right? They used to mistreat women. There would be economic injustice. There would be the spilling of blood for no reason. And the da'wah of the Prophet ﷺ changed society. And the da'wah of the Sahaba changed other societies too. To the point where you had the Ottomans. To the point where you had the likes of the people in Islamic Spain. It's because people gave them da'wah. You think they were just born Muslim just like that? No, someone had to convey the message. And this is why fundamentally, giving da'wah is the solution. Because if you want to have the harmony of Islam and the peace and justice of Islam around the world, then you need to convey that. You need to stop hiding and stop being fearful, stop having a complex. Break those inferiority complexes inside you. You have nothing to be afraid of, nothing to be ashamed of, nothing to hide. In actual fact, we need to stop being selfish. We're selfish. We have something so amazing that gives us peace and harmony, which is Islam. That we feel so happy that we're connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But yet we're not giving it to others. Don't be selfish, brothers and sisters. It's like a story of the man in a maze. We're in this maze. And behind us is our friends and family. And this maze is on fire. And we have to quickly find out how to get out of the maze in order to survive. But only you have been given the map. So what do? You get the map and you escape. But then you look behind you and the whole of the maze has burnt down and your friends and family have burnt. Do you know why? Because you never gave them the map as well. You never shared the directions. This person is a selfish person. Some would even say this person is an evil person. But this may be us, brothers and sisters. We live in the complex maze of life. It's on fire. We have friends and family. We have the map, which is the Quran. But we're keeping it to ourselves. And then we may survive. But maybe we've facilitated the destruction of our own friends and family. This is something to think about. Something to ponder upon. Something to understand. So brothers and sisters, we know many things about Ottoman history. We know many things about Islamic history. We preserve minorities, we create economic justice, we create harmony, we facilitated progress in European Renaissance. But in order for us to understand how we achieved this, we had to have hearts that deserved this success. And one way of actually creating the success or facilitating our hearts so we could have success is to do what? Is to do tadabbur of Quran. Is to repent to Allah. And is to dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These were the successful people. And also is to start to engage in the da'wah. To call people to Allah. Because calling people to Allah will give us success. It will answer our du'as. As Allah says in the Quran and as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says in the hadith. And to put on top of that, we get immense reward. So really, this is like a recipe for success. It's a pathway for success. Don't just be stuck in history. Understand the good that happened in history, but understand why it happened. It's because the people who did this had the right hearts and they were giving da'wah. So if there's any lesson that you take from today, make sure it's practical. That you start to work on your hearts and you start to work on others. So please, my beloved brothers, I love you for the sake of Allah. Seni seviyorum. I want you guys, please, because, you know, I've traveled in the past 6 weeks to Michigan, to Philadelphia, to Medina, to, I'm going to Texas, I'm going to Hong Kong. And when I do these travels, I don't want them to be lots of people, ah, very nice, well done, Hamza. This is rubbish. This is not ikhlas. This is like Bollywood or Hollywood. Yeah? Or Turkeywood. Right? Forget this. I really want you to just take some of these ideas and concepts and lessons and take them home and work on them. Honestly. So you know how to work on your heart, tadabbur of the Quran. Repent to Allah, engage in dhikr according to the Quran and Sunnah in an appropriate way that your heart is involved in what you're saying, and also start to live a life of da'wah. I believe this could be a recipe for success, a recipe for success inshallah. Because I'm going to tell you something. You may love your leader, Erdogan, right? We all love him, right? May Allah bless him and guide him. What if he dies? Who's going to replace him? The point I'm trying to say here is that good leadership comes from the people. So it's not only having good leaders, but it's having good followers. And these followers must have the right hearts and must call to the thing that these people call to, which is the harmony of Islam, which is the right ethics and values to create a good society, not only for Turkey, but for around the world. So don't think putting all your hopes on just one man. Islam doesn't work that way. Islam doesn't work that way. You have to be the change as well. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُغَيِّرُ. Indeed, unquestionably Allah will not change the situation of a people unless they change أَنفُسِهِمْ what's within themselves. So don't fall for the trap that you see great leaders and then you're not a reflection of them. Make sure you're a reflection of the people that you love. Engage in the path of fixing your heart, call others to Islam, I really believe we can have another Ottoman period, inshallah, if we do this. And we can do this all together, okay? You know, Europe needs it, especially Greece, yeah? Economic crisis, problems, concerns. Look what's happening in Syria. Look what's happening in Africa. Look what's happening all around the world. We need solutions, people. But these solutions are not going to be abstract ideology and abstract thinking. But this is going to come from people who are people of substance, with strong hearts, connected to Allah, and people who are brave enough to call to Allah. As I said, I gave you all the evidences. This gives success. So if you truly want success, then you know what to do now, okay? Make sure you do it, please, for the sake of Allah. Please, I beg you. Because on the Day of Judgment, I want to see all of you there with happy faces, with nur, with radiant faces, with the book in your right hand, and you ready to face Allah and say, you know, Allah, whatever you gave me, I did my best. I tried to fix myself. I'm a sinner. We all sin. And you said, well, you inspired the Prophet ﷺ to say that all of the son of Adam sins and the best of sinners are those who repent. So I was doing my best to fix my heart, but I also did my best to call to your way because I knew that's where the success lied. And Allah from His mercy, inshallah, who take you and say, go to paradise, go to eternal bliss. But we can only be deserving of that if we do it, right? If we do it. So do it in your own way as best as you can. You have great ulama here in this country. You have great imams, okay? Have a connection with them. And last point, I know I've gone too long, this final point, inshallah. At the moment, there is a cultural clash between the people who love Islam and the people who don't know much about Islam, but it's part of their culture, but they're more secular. Okay? There is this clash in Turkey at the moment. Even with me in London, with my old friends, many of them are secularists, and there's a bit of a clash. I've realized something. Don't forget, brothers and sisters, these people are your brothers and sisters. Don't see them as the other guys. Don't see them as the enemy. These people have suffered like you have. Their parents, their grandparents, they suffered from misinformation about Islam. They suffered from a social political movement that wanted to close the mouth of Islam. Don't blame them. They are a product of their society. They are a product of their cultures. Don't look at them and point the finger, because three fingers are pointing back. Remember, just because Allah gave you the ability to pray or to wear hijab or to be more Islamic, that doesn't mean you're better than anybody. And this is what you call the spiritual ego. It's one of the worst forms of ego. Don't judge people. The early pious predecessors of Islam, they would always speak to people with the view that that person will go to paradise before they did. Because you don't know people's ends. And you know the stories of the hadith. There could be someone who sinned all of his life and he dies on a good deed and he goes to paradise. And there could be someone who basically does good deeds all of his life and he dies on a sin and he goes to Jahannam. Don't have spiritual arrogance. Us and them. No. These are your people, your citizens, your brothers and sisters, your family. These are your fellow Turks. Don't fall for the satanic campaign that wants to divide. Give them da'wah. They don't know nothing about Islam. Wallahi, when you speak to them, they don't have a clue. They're just scared. They're scared because of the propaganda. They're scared because of the misinformation. They're scared because they don't know. You need to empower yourself and not go into the arguments and discuss and debate. Be mature and really see this as a symptom of a cause. It's a symptom of a cause. And that cause is, they don't know what you know. So use rahmah and be very patient with them as well. Because the last thing you want to see in this country is civil strife. Like what we saw in Taksim Square and we see in other places sometimes. We don't want this. We want a harmonious environment. Yes, people are going to disagree. But understand where people come from. Understand why they think the way that they think. Yes, it doesn't mean you have to agree with them, but understand them. Empathize with them. Have rahmah, and really show to them what the true Islam is about. I think this is going to be a big obstacle in Turkey. And I think you can solve it by not being arrogant, not thinking you're better than others, and really using rahmah and being intelligent and showing them the beauty of Islam and the beauty of your way. Don't fall for the two camps approach. Society is not a boxing match. It's far more complex than that. So this is why, brothers and sisters, please, let's not be the destruction of Turkey just because we took one side and we hated the other. Because Turkey won't be successful like that. No nation will be successful like that. A nation will be successful if the people who are carrying Islam, they convey in a way that people understand and people love. Even if they hate you for a while, even if they spit on you, even if they lie about you, even if they do all these things about you, have patience. Have patience and rahmah, and inshallah we'll be able to solve these small problems before they become too big. Okay? See them as your brothers. See them as your brothers and sisters that just need a little bit of help, because they don't know what you know. They haven't tasted the sweetness of connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sweetness of understanding Islam in a comprehensive way. Tamamna. Khair. Finally, honestly, I love being here. I love Turkey. I think Istanbul is the best city in the world. I'm not just saying that. I believe that before I used to give talks, because I came here in 2007 and 2008. And it's a beautiful city, you have great history, great people, your food is amazing. By the way, I'm a bit hungry, by the way, yeah? Yeah, I'm quite hungry, so I'm going to eat as well, inshallah. Maybe İskender çok güzel, huh? You know, you have great food, great people, great culture, great poetry, great spirituality. And, you know, I really pray to Allah that Allah facilitates you and you've learned something from today to start engaging with your heart and engaging in the da'wah. And, you know, all I could do is make dua for you guys. I don't live here, you live here. So I'm going to make lots of dua for you when I travel, inshallah, that Allah gives you success, that Allah gives your government success, that Allah gives you people success, and that you are not only successful for Turkey, but you're successful for the whole world. And this is what we want, okay? Because the only prime minister from the Muslim world that went to see the crisis of the Burmese, of the Rohingya, was the Turkish Prime Minister. He went to see them and he was crying. Yeah, we want more people like this. We want more of this rahmah. There's not enough rahmah in the world and we need more of it bi-iznillah. As Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said, where you see rahmah, you should see Islam. Turkiye, seni seviyorum. Selamu alaykum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bu güzel konuşmasından dolayı Hamza abiye teşekkür ediyoruz. Rabbim dünyamızı, dünyayı değiştiren kitap istikametinde değiştirmeyi nasip ve müyesser kılsın inşallah. Altyazı sistemindeki eksiklikten dolayı affınıza sığınıyoruz, kusura bakmayın. Şimdi kendisine hediyesini takdim etmek üzere Cerrahpaşa Tıp Fakültesi 4. sınıf öğrencimiz Sayın Muhammed Oduncu'yu buraya davet ediyorum.
Oh, tamam. Çok güzel.
Ayrıca programın düzenlemesinde emeği çok geçtiği için kendisine özel teşekkür ediyoruz Muhammed abiye. Diğer emeği geçen arkadaşlara da Allah razı olsun teşekkür ediyoruz. Bir dakika çıkmayalım, bir duyurumuz daha olacaktı.
Big selfie. Bir dakika. Bir dakika. Bir dakika. This is, I want you to give a message to the whole world. Say, Assalamu alaikum. Say, Osmanlı gelecek.
Osmanlı gelecek.
Takbir.
Allahu Ekber.
Takbir.